Good morning.
Good morning.
I forgot to put the background music on before I got here this morning, so I tried to add a couple things real quickly there, so it wasn't quite as smooth or as not as distorted as I hoped. But anyway, as I mentioned in my note when I sent out to you this morning, this is the day the Lord has made. What's the rest of it?
We will rejoice and be glad.
Are you rejoicing this morning? It is so good to be able to be back here worshiping together in this sanctuary and together with God's people. Every one of you that came in this morning, it was great to be able to see the joy in your face and the smile. Just the fun. And yeah, I'm not sure some of the other stuff on some of your faces, Rick, but it's good to see every single one of you here this morning. Well, tonight we are starting with Bama Hour Lenten services, as I've been sending out as well. We're going to be doing it by Zoom online. If you have the Zoom app, you can use the Zoom app. If you don't, you can go to zoom.us and find it as well. The link that I sent out, I'll be sending out again this afternoon. You just go to zoom.us, click on, fill in the number that is listed in that link that I will send out, and you will be joined in with the group. There's a gentleman over at the Green Nazarene Church that has the full program of the Zoom, the commercial program, and he's the one kind of hosting it, so he will go ahead and invite you in once you click in. We're going to have a song service again by video, a song that I chose and uploaded. We're going to have three of us speak this evening, and three of us speak for the next couple weeks as well. We will speak for 5 minutes apiece, and then go on to another song. Fred Keeter's going to be on this evening. He's going to be sharing from down south how things have been going with him down there. So that's going to be fun to hear how things are going for there. And we will do the same thing again, I don't know about Fred, but the same thing again on the 14th of March and on the 28th of March. So we're going to be doing Zoom, Internet, Bama, Lenten services online for 3 weeks, every other week during this Lenten season. And then this Thursday, of course, is the first Thursday of the month, so we'll be having board meeting here at the church as well. So with that said, are there any other announcements or notes, comments this morning before we continue on with our service? Well, are you ready to praise the Lord this morning? Would you like to say that we serve an almighty God, that he is indeed Lord of your life? Then let's praise him together, standing on our feet, shall we?
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise him, for he is thy health and salvation.
morning as we come to our prayer time. Who would like to praise the Lord? Don?
Great to be back.
All right. So glad to be face to face back.
Thank you. It's good to see each one of you as well. Anyone else? Yes, Lynn.
I praise and I'm thankful that I think almost everybody's well now. That we know of. So that was a rough time, but here we are.
And to the others.
Phil saw Paul Willrich this morning because he dropped something off for his boss, and there's a miracle right there. Mm-hmm. You know?
Wow.
Yeah. Oh, unfortunately, though, he didn't know church was today. Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
Must not have gone online.
But anyway.
This one didn't work either.
Anyone else? Yes, sir.
I have officially applied, been accepted, and registered for my doctorate program.
Wow.
Nice. Let's go to prayer requests. Anybody have something you'd like to lift up to the Lord this morning? Joker.
My sister of the heart in Illinois, Phyllis, has been in and out of the hospital repeatedly this last week. Oxygen levels were low, pulse rates were low, she was confused, she was having difficulty getting her out, and I haven't heard anything yet, but she's asked us to pray for her.
I would also pray for my cousin Glenn. He has had a heart attack and don't know any more information. But from Joanne, I will pray that all the bills and decisions be made for my present president be somehow overturned. And President Trump speaks today at 3:30. And his words would once again bring hope to American people.
Phil's brother Paul had surgery Wednesday on his spine. Still in the hospital, running a low-grade fever. So prayer for that, and that you know, he can get through this and get to rehab to be able to get home.
Our sister-in-law Brenda Loomis Nisnik. She's going in for surgery tomorrow for an upper hernia operation. Seems pretty critical.
Anyone else?
Unspoken.
Okay, and I'm sure the Lord knows each one of our hearts for those unspoken requests. Yes,
John. Just all the hours that.
Pardon?
All the hours that we've been putting in at work, 70 hours a week.
we are so excited to be able to be here in this house this morning. Lord, we know that you have always been with us throughout this past year, no matter what's been going on in our lives, especially during this virus and all. But Lord, we also thank you for the fact that your word tells us that we are all part of your church, and that your church has never declined during this time period, but that it has always stayed full and fresh, and we thank you for that. We thank you, though, for the opportunity to indeed be able to be back here in this sanctuary worshiping together as a people. We also thank you for the chance to be able to bring our concerns before you. Lord, we do pray for Joy's sister, who's been in and out of hospital with a low O2 sat and pulse down. We pray that you will work in whatever way needs to be to bring all that up and heal her. We pray for Carol's cousin with his heart attack. Touch them, Lord, in whatever way they need. Bring them closer to you through all of this. We thank you for Joanne's prayer that our president would be able to be directed by you, and that as Trump speaks, that he would bring some hope to the nation through his words. We also pray for Bill's brother Paul with the spine surgery and with the temp continuing to go up a little bit. Lord, touch that, bring that temp down, bring healing, and let him be back to a place where he can go to another place of healing very quickly here. We pray for Brenda, who is also going into surgery for her surgery tomorrow. Father, I pray that you will touch her mind, her heart. If she doesn't know you, Lord, draw her close to you, bring people across her path to let her know that you love her. We pray for those who are having all kinds of work hours, for Darlene and Jim and others at CraftMate. Lord, I pray you give them strength not only in physically, but strength mentally and spiritually and emotionally as well, that they may be able to be good witnesses wherever they are at work. We pray for safety for each one of us. And Lord, we thank you for your word that reminds us to pray for those in the government. Lord, we know that there's all kinds of differences of opinions right now that's going about. Lord, we do know that your word tells us to pray for those who are in government. So we pray for those that you would lead and guide and direct and give strength where strength is needed, and take down where take down is needed, and whatever ways needed, Lord. Just leave all that in your hand. We'll thank you. Well, what does a potter's wheel do? What does somebody on a potter, who is a potter, do? It goes around and around, and it moves the lump of clay to something that is useful. So do you think that God has something useful in mind for you this morning? You think that God has something eternal in mind for you this morning? Something that God wants to use you for eternity? If so, let's indeed bow before him this morning and surrender to what he needs to do in each one of our lives, shall we?
Thank you.
which you gain eternal life. Jesus says, why do you ask me about what is good? There's only one who is good. If you want to enter life, obey the commandments. Which ones? The man inquired. Jesus replied, do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, do not give false testimony. Honor your father and mother and love your neighbor as yourself. All these I've kept, the young man said. What still do I lack? Jesus answered, if you want to be perfect, go, sell your possessions, give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come and follow me. When the young man heard this, he was sad, and he went away, because he had great wealth. One of the sadder verses in Scripture, he went away because he couldn't bear to part with something that was more important to him than Jesus. Jesus said at one point to take up your cross and follow me. Taking up your cross means something different for every one of us. But for every one of us, it means asking that question. Are we willing to give up all, no matter what it is that we feel like we may want to hang on to? Jesus gave his all, and he loved his body to be broken for you and for me. Let's take it. Simply the 10% of which we kind of, it's his anyway, we should be giving it to him, but then also I have a feeling that somebody's been giving some offerings over and above your tithes, and I know that God's been pleased with that, and we praise him for the way that he has blessed us through this time, and I'm excited to know how, but especially when I see the treasury report, how God indeed has continued to bless our Christian church through your account, through your gifts to him. So let's stand together and sing the doxology. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly. provided for, not only us individually, and you fulfilled your promises and your word, but you've continued to provide for this church, and we thank you for that. Continue to bless these offerings that we have brought before you this morning, and we pray that you'll continue to use them, especially for eternity. Lord, help us to be wise in our meetings, in the way that we disperse the funds, that we will indeed be able to see things when we look back from eternity, things that happen because of our gifts to you. And we'll give you the praise for it, which in your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Well, we are in the Lenten season. I saw a Lenten series suggestion once, but were you there? Well, I decided that I wasn't necessarily going to use the "you were there," but I did decide that I thought it might be interesting to look at some of the characters that were there, specifically Christ's disciples over these next 5 weeks. So I want to take a look at least five of the disciples that were there with him and to see what we can learn from their lives. For the last year, we've been looking at some Old Testament characters, some normal people just like you and I, and how they have accomplished absolutely incredible things for God because of their willingness to be able to serve God no matter what. And I trust that you have been challenged as I have been as well as we've been studying these characters. Well, today, as we kind of go away and transition from Old Testament characters to the New Testament characters, I thought it might be good for us to take a look at some folks who perhaps helped to change our world from what it was then to what it is today, spiritually speaking. Lent is perhaps could be considered a little bit of a dark time because it's a time of introspection. It's a time that we try to prepare ourselves for a coming of Easter. Many times we look at what Christ did for us when he went to the cross. He came to this earth. Why did he come? To go to the cross. Before time began, he knew that he needed to be the sacrifice to pay the penalty for your sin and for my sin so that we would not have to pay that penalty. And a lot of times during Lent, we kind of focus on that a bit. So along the kind of, if you will, the darkness of the season, I wanted to start today by looking at the life of somebody that I've never preached about in the last 33 years. I've touched on him a little bit in passing over a few times, but we've never really looked at his life, and that is the disciple Judas. Now, there are two Judas disciples, and this one is not the one who was the son of James, the son of Zebedee, but Judas Iscariot. Iscariot was not necessarily his last name, but it simply means a man from Kiriath. Judas was also the apostle who carried the purse for Jesus and the disciples. He was their treasurer. And the one that most believed that was probably the one that asked Jesus in John 12 about the wasting of the money when the woman came in and poured perfume all over Jesus' feet and said that, well, shouldn't we have sold it and given it to the poor? And then verse 7, of course, we know Jesus kind of rebukes him a little bit. It's always been a popular idea in the church to give your kid a biblical name. One associate pastor has three brothers named Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Guess what his name is?
John.
Nope. That's Timothy. I guess the parents didn't want to sound too spiritual by naming their kids Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. So he's Timothy. But you know, some of the most popular names are actually biblical names. Think about it. You got Peter and John and Andrew, Andy, and Philip, and Tom, and Matthew. I'll bet you we all know Pete, and Tom, and John, and Andy, and so forth. But how many Judases do you know? How many social situations have you been in where, hey, Corey, come here, let me introduce you to Tom, Matt, and Judas? Don't happen. Nobody names their kid Judas because that name is associated with one of the most reviled characters in all of history, Judas Iscariot. And neither do you hear anyone who is an American patriot and a historian name their kid Benedict. Also, a betrayer. But even so, you know, I find this universal condemnation sometimes just a little odd. Because Judas was not the one who accused, who turned his back on, who lied about his association, who who tried, who condemned, who sentenced, who mocked, who hit, who spit upon Jesus. He didn't put a whip on his back or a nail through his wrist or hands. And yet he is often thought of as the essence of evil in this story. You know, I guess anybody could do any of those other things, but only a true friend can betray it. Especially a friend. Betrayal is a very personal offense. You know, nobody goes to Benedict Arnold Elementary School, and nobody names their kid Judas. Judas is a rather complex character, though, and he cannot necessarily be painted with just a one broad paintbrush. He's been portrayed in a variety of ways, from heinous villain to unfortunate victim. Remember the first time I heard Jesus Christ Superstar? It came up when I was in high school, and I was a bit surprised and shocked at how sympathetic the portrayal of Judas was given. I always assumed that he was an opportunistic person trying to make a quick buck, and Superstar doesn't quite do that. When I was in college, the greatest opera bass singer in the world at the time, Jerome Hines, he was a Christian. In fact, he came to know the Lord through, I think I may have mentioned in the past, through a direct audible voice of God. God spoke to him audibly, and Jerome said, okay, kind of like when Jesus talked to disciples. And Jerome Hines, he was such a great opera singer that he was the first and only person up to that time that had ever been asked to sing a Russian lead in a Russian opera in Moscow. He was that well respected around the world. Well, he wrote an opera about the life of Jesus Christ called The Way. It was going to be The Way, the Truth, and the Life, but he never got around to the next two things. But he came to Minneapolis when I was in college to present this opera, The Way, about the life of Christ. And man, I got tickets as soon as I heard about it. And there's nothing going to keep me from it. Well, we had 12 to 18 inches of snow that day. I was not going to allow anything to keep me from that. And so I borrowed my dad's great big old grand marquee, you know, those things that would stretch from the wall to here. Well, not quite, but close. And I put chains, tire chains on it, and I went an hour and a quarter to see Jerome Hines play The Way. Well, I was a little surprised as well then to see his portrayal of Judas as kind of trying to hurry up the political agenda that he saw. He wanted to help Jesus to accomplish what Jesus was supposed to do according to his idea of the Messiah. And then also to kind of hurry up his ability to get some more money at the treasure of the new kingdom.
Yes.
But there is more to Judas than meets the eye. Now, we don't know a whole lot about him, but the Gospels don't tell us necessarily about when he was called, how he was called. We don't know a whole lot about him, but we can really assume, probably rightly so, that he came with the same excitement that the rest of the disciples did, the same plans and, he was excited to see what was going to happen in the future, whatever that word is. He didn't join with a plan to betray him. He saw Jesus, he believed, he followed, he was excited. We also know he was chosen to be the treasurer for the disciples. And so he had to display some kind of positive characteristics. This office isn't given to just anybody. Probably indicates the degree of esteem to which they held him. And yet Judas isn't even mentioned in Matthew's gospel until chapter 10. And even at that first mention, he's not mentioned as the money keeper, but as the one who betrayed Jesus. So the burning question comes before us this morning is, why did Judas do it? In their Gospels, Luke and John both say that Satan entered Judas and caused him to do what he did. Some say that, you know, this is all part of God's plan, and Judas didn't have a choice. But if that's so, that kind of lets Judas off the hook. I don't believe that either God or Satan controlled Judas like a marionette on a puppet string. Because do we ever lose our free will, our ability to make choices? If we excuse Judas for what happened, then it's become very easy to make excuses for our own problems. Oh, the devil made me do it! The devil made me do it! You know, we can excuse, but it doesn't change the fact that Judas had
choice, why would he have been so grieved about it that he'd take his own life? Judas has as much culpability in the crucifixion as anyone else. So why did he choose to betray Jesus? There are several theories that abound. First one is that Judas was greedy. He wanted to betray him for the cash, but then that doesn't really quite fit in with what we know about the story. The amount of money that he was given was a modest amount of money. It was the amount of money that you might give for an injured slave, not that great. He later returns the money. And as treasurer, he did dip his hand in every so often, we're told in scripture. So he wasn't hurting for money. There's something more at work here than just greed. Another theory is that he was disappointed that Jesus wasn't the military hero that the Jews were expecting. That's what I was kind of referring to a little bit ago. Judas's surname, even though Kyriath may have been from Kyriath, it also means dagger bearer. It's a Greek word, sicario, meaning dagger bearer, which was kind of associated with the zealots of that time. And they would do everything that they could to undermine the Roman authority. Judas may very well have been looking for Jesus to be a savior that could lead this rebellion. And when Judas realized that Jesus was not that kind of leader, he betrayed him out of anger, revenge, disappointment. And then a third reason that's out there kind of puts the first two together, that Judas wasn't just greedy or angry, but like Jerome Hines says, he was just actually trying to help Jesus in his mission. He knew from the Old Testament, at least their concept of the Old Testament, what the Messiah was supposed to do to come and vanquish Rome and to establish God's kingdom on earth, and he felt that Jesus just wasn't moving fast enough. Judas had become disillusioned because Jesus was talking about dying rather than setting up a new kingdom that would have made it so much easier for them. Judas may have thought, no, if I can just kind of nudge him a little bit, maybe I can force his hand, and then he won't have any choice but to act. Fact matters, I believe that what Judas did, he did, because Jesus was not the Savior that Judas wanted him to be. Judas was not the Savior that Judas wanted him to be. Now, it's very easy for us to have contempt for Judas. He's the Judas, the betrayer. And it's easy to kind of distance ourselves from him. Oh, I would never do that. But you know, put in the right position or wrong position, depending on how you want to look at it. Facing the right amount of pressure, we can all find ourselves betraying. Betraying God, betraying Jesus, betraying each other. The question for us is not if we are going to betray Jesus, but when. The power of sin in our lives is so very strong. And without being absolutely, totally sold out to Jesus, it's so easy to succumb to sin. I'm doing some tag team counseling with somebody this week, and my buddy had come out of a very tough time years back, and we were both dealing with someone else in the middle of a rather tough time. And he said, you know, when I came out of that situation, I had to make a choice. I had to either live 100% and totally committed to serving Jesus Christ in anything and everything, or I would just be like some of those namby-pamby Christians that I used to see in churches that I used to call hypocrites. He said, in order to be able to stand firm for Christ, in order to be able to do what God wanted me to do, in order to be able to combat the sin that was hanging on from the past, I needed to live my life 100% and completely, total, soul, sold out to Jesus Christ. And without that kind of a commitment, it is impossible to withstand the devil. Both Matthew and Mark mentioned the story of the betrayal of Christ, that the devil entered him just before he did his deed. I know maybe in empathy for him, they tried to put something down that would not put their friend in a total bad light for all of history. But would he have been willing to betray Jesus If he had been willing to listen to everything that Jesus had to say with the right amount of heart attitude. You know, we can all get sidetracked by the old devil if we are not careful to listen to God every day through his word and through prayer. After his crucifixion, Matthew states that Judas returned the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests, and he stated that he had shed innocent blood. He didn't care for the money, but he had a little bit of remorse. Matthew then states that Judas went out and hanged himself. The priest took the money. They used the money to buy a potter's field to bury the poor. Peter states in Acts that he fell headlong over a cliff and his insides burst open. Even when guilt had overcome Judas, he repented to the wrong people, to the priests and the Pharisees and the officials. You know something? An apology to Christ probably would have saved his soul. But he saw no way out, and he killed himself. Ultimate giving up. So why did Jesus call Judas? Did Jesus know it was going to happen? Of course he did. Before the beginning of time, God in Trinity, including God the Son, had put together this whole plan because of his love for you and I, because of his knowledge of how people would determine their lives, the choices that they would make. Jesus chose him on purpose, knowing what would happen all the while. Judas didn't trick Jesus. Now, God knew his choices. Did that make Judas not culpable? Of course not. God knows your choices. Does that mean that you are not responsible for your sin? Of course not. But God, hallelujah, is always able to work all things out, including his knowledge that he was going to be betrayed by Judas for good, for eternal good. Judas is still culpable because of his choices. God just knew it, and he used it. Now, part of the reason that Jesus chose Judas was to fulfill Scripture's prophecy. There were nearly 200 scriptures, prophecies that Jesus fulfilled when he was on this earth. Psalm 41, Scripture says that the Messiah is going to be betrayed. And Zechariah 11 says that it's going to be for 30 pieces of silver. He did it to prove his deity. The fulfillment of these many dozens and actually cut on nearly 100, 200 scriptures, prophecies, to choose that he was going to be the Messiah. He chose him to show that the church can indeed overcome tragedy and even divisiveness. And isn't that necessary in today's day and age? So did Judas go to heaven or hell? Jesus answers that question in John 17, 12. None of them is lost except the Son of Perdition. Matthew 26, he answers and he says, he that dips his hand with me into the bowl is the one that's going to be betrayed. The Son of Man is going to go just as it is written, but woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for him had he never been born. In Acts 1:25, Paul states that Judas went to his own place after his death. Is there any reason that Jesus would have said it would have been better for him had he never been born? If he was in heaven. No. Good Christians can go back. Can fall away. Even those who have been mightily used by God. Judas was one of the 12 disciples that went out. They were given the power to cast out devils, to heal the sick. He went out with them and he did so. He had an anointing. He had what many of us would love to have. How would you like to be able to cast out any demon that may come anywhere near you? How many of you would like to bring anybody healed, make anybody healed that is sick? Judas had that ability through the power of God. Judas called Jesus master on several occasions. Is he master of your life? trying to get into heaven as a group. Judas hung around the right crowd. You know something? He had the perfect pastor. He heard the best sermons. He had a pretty good Facebook profile. Just because you go to church on Sundays, just because you listen to great sermons and read the right books, it doesn't mean that you're not going to blow it. Just because you walk with God and talk with God and are handpicked by God doesn't necessarily mean you're going to blow it. The path is narrow, and it has to be a heartfelt decision. I'll bet you Judas looked really good on Sunday, on the Sabbath, on Saturday morning. Have you ever been a traitor? Ever betrayed someone's trust? Judas chose something over God. Have you ever done that? There are things that keep us out of church. There are things that keep us from visiting people, from witnessing, from tithing, from forgiving, from making a simple phone call to other people in the church. How many of you have called people in this past year from the church? A lot of you have. Are we tantalized with the pursuit of things? Are things perhaps at the forefront of our life? Are there things that are more important to us than Jesus? Can you honestly pray without ceasing if you are constantly asking for stuff? Building a relationship with God is more than simply ordering like you do at a fast food restaurant. You ever want to try to get even with somebody? Even somebody pulled out in front of you on the road? Vengeance is mine, says the Lord. Judas was sorry for what he did, but he did not seek forgiveness from God. Learn from his mistake. We have to actually and sincerely repent every time. It's not assumed. Matthew tells us that after his betrayal, Judas was overcome with remorse. Starting point, but it didn't go any farther than that. Not the same as repentance. It's one thing for feeling bad for something that you've done, but quite another to actively and sincerely seek for forgiveness, which means to turn away from and never do it again, and reconciliation with that person with whom you've wronged. Remorse means that I go to that person and I say, I'm sorry for what I've done. I never should have done that. And Judas never did that. After his betrayal, he does not return to the community of disciples where forgiveness would have been found. We need our community most when we are at our lowest. And Judas doesn't realize this. Instead, he suffers alone. He increases in despair. He's unwilling to think that he can be forgiven until his remorse takes his own life. And by doing so, Judas misses the whole point of the crucifixion. If he would have stayed around, he would have known the joy and the excitement of the resurrection. He would have known that Jesus came to liberate us from the power of sin and to offer us forgiveness. And that no one is outside of the realm of God's forgiveness. Including Judas, had he been willing to go to him. No one has fallen so far, as my friend can tell you that I talked with this week. No one can fall so far that they are not eligible to receive God's forgiveness. But Judas' life was cut short. And we run the same risk. We are not willing to humble ourselves and to acknowledge. You know, we can be physically close, but so far away. Like Judas, we are all tempted to make Jesus into what we want him to be. We want him to give us what we want. We want him to heal when we want him to heal. We want him even to leave us alone when we want to be left alone. And when that doesn't happen, when Christ does not fit our mold, we get disillusioned and we make ourselves vulnerable to the forces of evil around us. Professing faith in Christ means acknowledging that it is not Jesus that can be changed changed by us, but us that need to be changed by Jesus. It means acknowledging that it is not Jesus that can be changed by us, but it is us that need to be changed by him. If only Judas had been open to receiving forgiveness, he would have lived long enough to discover the joy of the empty tomb. And thankfully, we still have that choice. We still have that chance. We have that choice to open our hearts. Those of you that may be seeing us online there, you have that choice to make that decision. That choice to ask for forgiveness. That choice to be changed for better. Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood of Jesus. Let's stand together as we close this morning, shall we? Are you grateful for the blood of Jesus? Hallelujah. Life that is indeed a life that can bring eternality to everything that we do.
Lord, we want to honor you this morning with our praises, with our voices, even with our eating and drinking, like I've shared a couple times in the devotionals. And Lord, for all that, we'll look forward to what you are going to do because of decisions made today. For it's in your precious name we pray. Amen. 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 Have a great week. I love you. It's great to see you once again.